Good morning, everyone, and thanks for the introduction. I work for Zebia Labs, and I work for implementing the different products that Zebia Labs has. So at Zebia Labs, we build tools to support DevOps at continuous delivery. So you know, we have tools in the release automation, deployment automation, and test space. And we have a booth out also, so you know, you can come and talk to me about these tools there. So today, you know, I'll be talking about one of these implementation assignments that I did in the US. It is a payroll processing company, and how from their old methods of delivering releases, how they turn themselves into faster release cycle, and that essentially we talk about in continuous delivery and DevOps. This company, what they do is they offer products to support businesses for payrolls. So they do payrolls and human resources from very small companies to very large companies. So because of that, they had very varying range of applications. Because for supporting small and medium businesses, they had some small applications, maybe software as a service based applications, because that's what SMBs like. And for bigger enterprises, they had something more mature, and which they can host, the enterprises can host on-premise. So they had a very wide-ranging set of applications. They had a team of around 100,000 plus associates in IT, and a big customer base of 540,000 customers. So that is ranging from very, very small businesses to very large corporations. So with that, they had challenges of multiple tools, because different sets of application, different sets of requirements. So every application team, they're using their own tools, right? Because of those tools, I mean, it is creating a spaghetti of all these tools, and there are a lot of tool supporting teams that they had to build. And also a lot of custom integrations, because once they build the application, and then when they grow that, probably some other customer comes in and they want something else. So they build custom integration on top of that. So it was becoming very difficult for them to manage. Obviously, with all these application teams, they were following different processes. They had a lack of project visibility. When a project, they would start, and the project has to maneuver through multiple application teams, the project managers were not able to visualize that, okay, what should be my end date of the project. It was very difficult to determine for them. Also the reporting, I say hi for them. Okay. So the reporting was also a problem for them, because again, fetching all this data from all these different application teams, and there is no uniform automation pieces there. So getting that information, and then information is very important from the release process in order to improve upon that. Because unless I have that data in front of me, I cannot retrospect and probably improve upon it, right? So because of that manual and outdated reporting, they were not able to do that as well. So these were some of the challenges that they were facing. So back in, I went for this implementation in 2014, but I got to know the story, the entire story when I was there. So this was the mission that they started off with in 2011, to maximize the power of their teams. So some of the points that I've highlighted here are probably, they resonate very well with what we just heard, from Ria Group as well, that, what kind of things that are there in the DevOps space. So active engagement and collaboration, increasing the reliability of delivery, that means optimizing the value stream, right? And maximizing the power of the people. So whatever the people are working on, how to get maximum value out of it. And also, there was this inspiration from some of the biggest companies who are doing this thing very well, actually. So these are some mind-boggling numbers you can look at, and there is a source of it, so I'm not making this up. Amazon is doing not many deploys a day. So their deploy lead time is in minutes. Google, Netflix. So these are, you know, some of the pioneers who have achieved this to a, you know, very great extent. So these were some of the triggers for, you know, these in the company, in the case study as well, that okay, when these people are doing it, probably, you know, we should do something about it and, you know, improve upon our existing release sets. So how did they enable that vision that I talked about? So first of all, they started off in phases. So they started off with the agile transition, first of all, because they had to fix up, you know, how development is delivering. If development is really faster, then probably, you know, they can fix up the entire thing. So they started off with agile transition first, and then segregated, you know, created multiple portfolios and programs on agile. So as I said, they had multiple different application teams. So on top of that, they created agile portfolios and program teams who can deliver across that entire multiple set of application teams. Then the last set was enabling the entire release automation. So continuous delivery enablement with the right set of tools. And what are the tools I'll talk about? So with Agile, they also used some of the collaborative lifecycle management tools. They established tracks with backlog. So initially they had you know, the waterfall model. So you know, they were working on create means ad hoc change requests were coming, and that way. Here they established these backlogs, and the team started doing Agile. They had multiple SCM tools, so that was becoming difficult for them to, you know, have one set of continuous integration framework in place. So they did a SCM migration to two SCM tools, actually. No, not a single SCM tool, because a small bit is still in one other SCM tool. They did better reporting with these lifecycle management tools. So at least the part that I was talking about, that at least some data they were getting from their releases now. That okay, in this release probably, you know, this was the planning, and this is if across application teams we are doing this planning, this is the timeline that we are looking at. So because of setting up these tools, they got to do this better reporting. But the piece that is still missing is there is not enough automation. All these lifecycle management tools, the data filling is still you know, a lot manual. So I used this picture here because I think it was relevant to explain this concept. So this, you know, at GBL Labs we have created this. So this is a release train kind of depiction for DevOps. So essentially the parts that I talked about, and it fits in this story precisely, because, you know, the parts I was talking about. So initially the three boxes here are development teams who are doing Agile, and they're getting their prioritized stories, and they're writing stories, they're writing code. So essentially they are, you know, developing that package that would go on some servers to run. Once they have written all this code, so we cannot automate this, we need people to do it, right? When this code is lying here, it is of no value unless it reaches production and, you know, serves my customers. So if I can automate the rest of the pieces, which can take this piece of software reliably to my production systems, I'm good. So these the four pieces of automation here are automation and build, the continuous integration that we do with, you know, tools like Jenkins, TeamCity, and Bamboo, and a lot of companies are which I see are already there. The pieces that are missing are automation and provisioning. So automation and provisioning means you have to you have the build software with probably some kind of unit tests also have run on it. So you have some degree of reliability of that piece of software. What kind of environment it would run on, you have to provision it at runtime if you are running on the cloud. Or maybe, you know, you would like to have a replicable you know, set of environment. So automation and provisioning is another piece. Automation and deployment. So once you have the environment ready, you have the package ready. Now, how do I ensure that it is deployed also automatically? Because if I have a big cluster of environment, how do I, you know, deploy this package to all these pieces reliably? So that piece is automation and deployment. Then you have you need to test the software whether it works fine on your machines that you have deployed on. So if I can figure out these four pieces of automation, I can make this particular release train go faster, right? And then I can put some kind of monitoring, which would become which would give some feedback to my next set of stories, and I complete the feedback loop. Right. So this is essentially what these guys did. So they started off with this, then moved, put some bit of CI in place, and then the rest of the pieces. So the story that I talked about so far was they already had automation in build. They were doing some kind of automation testing as well, but the missing pieces still were automation in deployment and automation in provisioning, and how to tie it together. So the benefits here by using this entire release string go faster would be there would be higher productivity of the teams, because teams are now essentially focusing on developing the software more, and probably how to get it to production faster can be figured out by the tools. So it would be a one-time effort to set up, right, to set up the framework for those tools, but I can potentially go faster. Which will essentially lower my costs and improve the time to market as well. It would improve the resource utilization and cooperation across the teams as well, because they are using similar set of tools. So the key for DevOps is, as we heard earlier as well, that if we are using the same set of tools for development and operations, they understand each other better. So with putting all those release train views, so essentially all these pieces, if the dev is also using same kind of tools in order to deploy to their dev environments, and then ops is also using the same kind of tools, they understand each other's problems better. And also, with this automation, we reduce the chances of human error, because a lot of the ops activities, if people are writing scripts, or people are continuously doing deployments, the monotony sets in, and there are chances of human errors coming in. So what was the technology landscape for this particular company that I talked about? So they had a lot of Linux servers, some Solaris servers, and some Windows servers for some of their utilities. They had a WebLogic application server farm that they were using for most of their deployment. They had some Apache web servers. For CI, they were using Jenkins. So this was before I came in. And then for some of the front-end utilities, they were using IIS servers. And for database, they were using Oracle. So probably you could see more or less similarity to what probably you guys are also seeing in your set of projects. So the journey from having set up the CI, and from there to continuous delivery, what were the kind of challenges they were facing? So firstly, environment creation for them was largely manual, so it was taking a lot of time for them to build the environment first and then go ahead and deploy on them. So probably that was one key pain point that they were trying to address. And as I talked about, they had disparate tools across their different applications, so they probably had to streamline their tool set as well. Then there was a problem of there was a debate on how the deployment pipeline should look like. So this has some relation with the disparate tools as well, because there was lot of ideas coming in from both the organizations. So they have their dev organization being set up and the ops organization being set up. So conflicting tool ideas come into play, that what should we use for probably provisioning, what kind of tools should we go for deployment automation. So a lot of conflicting ideas. And they had to settle through all those ideas and find the best optimal solution. And then how do they keep improving? So again, they probably wanted to use a tool which would give them real-time data which they can retrospect upon and improve their releases release on release. So this was the choice of tools that they went with. So for automated deployment, they used Excel Deploy. For automated provisioning, they used Puppet. And for release automation, they used Excel Release. And I'll show how they have used it. So this was their architecture diagram post the implementation. So they were they reduced all the SCM tools to Subversion and Git. So all things were moved to these two, primarily Git and less of Subversion. They had set up their build management as Ant and Maven, and for CI they were using Jenkins. The artifacts were being managed in Nexus, so that was being set up. For unit testing, they were using JUnit, Clover, MS Build, so some tools for Java-based development and some for Microsoft. For smoke test, they were using JTAF. For labeling, they were using Git and Subversion. And for application deployment, they were using Excel Deploy. And for having this process automated, they were using Excel Release. So Excel Release was triggering all these different processes. And for monitoring, they had set up Nagios on top of their QC and prod environments. So what are the kind of checks and the checks they were doing? So for build records, they were checking how much time my build is running. So then by checking the build time, they were kind of optimizing that build time. So making some measures in order to how we can achieve lesser build times. Then test the coverage reports. Obviously, they were trying to achieve better coverage with that. For the deploy reports, they were measuring the throughput, that how many deployments they're doing per week. So they were at a per week level. Probably they might have gotten better by now. But at that time, they were kind of measuring that how many deploys they're using per week. So that was kind of data. And how much is the deployment time? So for each and every deployment to different environments, and I'll show the numbers as well. So what kind of deployment time we are looking at? Here comes the is not of the cultural part. So as I talked about conflicting ideas from dev and ops organization for these tools, so that was a very challenging thing for them, and I think that would apply to many other organizations as well. That how do you get through all these different ideas, and how do you settle on one single idea? So here, I think what made the difference was they had very good executive support, and with the executive support, they organized a separate continuous delivery team who was chartered to find out these tools, and this team would listen to all the ideas and come out with recommendations on the tools. Obviously, they had a complex structure, as I mentioned. So lot of apps teams are there, in which a lot of developers are there who are giving all these ideas about the tools. They had a very risk-sensitive culture. So as as any of the finance-related organization would have, they wanted to have very less impact on the users, because direct business was hit if something goes wrong in the software or service-based application. So very risk-sensitive culture was there. So this is how their pipeline looked like for one of the environments. They had done infrastructure building for only the dev environment for them. Essentially all these tasks are sequential in nature, and one task finishes, another one appears. So essentially they had an infrastructure phase and an application phase for each of their environments. In the infrastructure phase, they are using Puppet. So with Excel Deploy is calling Puppet behind the scenes. So and this particular flow is being triggered by a Git commit. So they were they had their infrastructure template, basically the Puppet file in Git. And then once they make some changes in that Git file, this particular flow gets triggered. This flow triggers the Puppet module, and which creates the environment. Then it goes ahead and fetches the new machine IP that has been created. It runs another Puppet module, which installs application servers, so basically builds the environment so that we can use and deploy to that environment. Then couple of web calls, which have been tied using the webhooks, so a couple of REST API calls, in order to tell the deploy tools that okay, this is what my new environment looks like. And then they went ahead and created a record in ServiceNow that, okay, this particular environment is now created and ready for release. Then the application, in the application phase, they triggered Jenkins, which would create a build. Once the build is created, it would deploy this build to this newly developed environment, and then some test tasks. So basically, test tasks will vary on what kind of application it is. So you know, some applications using JUnit, some using MS Build. So respective, respective tests were run. And then at the end of it, it would update the ServiceNow record that, okay, now it is available in dev. And it would follow through if that particular application team is using the tools in other, means bigger environments as well. So what are the quantitative benefits that they got out of it? So if I talk about their dev or test environments, without continuous delivery, while they were using, you know, all the script-based deployment, so there was a lot of preparation time that was going in. While setting up how to run the scripts and all, so they were consuming about 2 hours to, you know, do the deployments on their dev and test environment, which was reduced to 5 minutes because essentially it was a single-click deployment that they achieved. For deployment to pre-prod and production, also there are, you know, some similar numbers. So other benefits that they achieved by using this continuous delivery was obviously one that I talked about, reduced preparation time. It improved the communication a lot because everybody is looking at that same pipeline view, right? And everybody in the team has access to, when the release gets triggered, everybody has access to, okay, which exact task my release is at. So which improved the communication a lot because there is no, you know, back and forth chat communication or email communication that, okay, where my release is stuck. They obviously had capability to deploy faster as we saw the numbers, and the environment utilization was improved because if I'm using a SaaS-based application, I'm not, because of the preparation time, I'm not losing that time of my application being done. So since it is the entire flow that is going on, and making very effective environment utilization. This is a quote from one of the team members there, so probably means I found funny. So he says XMD is the end of tribal knowledge as we know it. So in the old way of doing things, he was referring as tribal knowledge. Some changes to the team composition as well, and I found a great similarity to what Ria is doing. They are also doing almost the same things. So they merged their release implementation teams and the application operations teams. So they, because that made sense, and that eventually made the continuous delivery team. So this team was chartered to maintain the tools for continuous delivery. And probably, you know, the support group was created for the entire application teams. They obviously had, since they were focusing a lot on automation, they had to focus on automation testing a lot. So each application team was, you know, kind of encouraged to use more and more automation testing. For the build engineers, they were trained to take more DevOps roles. So basically, these build engineers, again, some of them part of the application operation teams. So they were, trained in these new tools that I talked about. So you know, some of them got trained in Puppet, some of them in release automation and deployment automation. And then gradually, they were turning themselves into provider of environments. So this entire continuous delivery team, they would give this framework for the application team to host their applications on. The cultural part was that not many of the application team project managers or project owners, they were not ready to, you know, make that shift to continuous delivery. So they had the challenge of promoting this particular initiative within their organization as well. So for that matter, on the go live day, so you know, some of the application teams who agreed to onboard their applications, host their applications on this new environment, new way of doing things, all the other application teams were invited, and you know, there was a big basically conference room and projector being set up, and then this is how the go live was done. So that just to promote within their organization that okay, this particular this thing works, and you know you can host your applications probably with some effort on this platform. And the celebration. So this was a team in the US, and they were a set of hunters. So hunting, and so I managed to convince them to shoot only the non-living objects. So that was a good thing, right? And probably this this could be a very well way of having mingling with the teams also. So this was their idea of going out and having parties. I am not sure about the source, but I really like this continuous delivery evaluation picture. So on level one, and there are different parts to it. So different levels of DevOps maturity, and on the scale of DevOps, on scale of monitoring, on scale of testing, provisioning, deploying, and building, how well you are doing. So they are probably at level three, wherein the development operations are working together when this is required, and they are trying to achieve the level five, where operation and development are both part of the multidisciplinary team. So they are still siloed. They have the application team being set up and a continuous delivery engine being set up as a support. So probably as a true DevOps level five, this is the place to achieve. Yeah.
Pipeline that you showed,
yeah.
You have an infrastructure before the application build.
Yeah.
Is it something that you do per application? The setup of the environment machine, the per build of the application?
Yes. So if say for instance the software as a service based application, so they want to host it on a cloud. So they have an environment template that how it should look, right? So they would host that environment template into the source control. When you change that environment template typically has that, okay, what kind of, these many application servers I want, these many database servers I want, right? And then once you make that change, it goes on to that particular cloud provider. It could be AWS, Azure. It hits that, it creates that environment for you, and then you onboard that environment into your deployment solution. And then you go ahead and deploy your application on. So essentially, it is tying the infrastructure creation part and the build deployment part as well. So first you build the environment, then you build the application, then you deploy on it.
Thank you.
Sorry, yeah. A little bit unclear on the answer. So what you're saying is that after every Git commit, builds a new environment for that particular version of the application,
yeah,
and then switches off from the current version to the new version.
So the Git commit in this case I'm talking about is, in Git what is hosted is the environment specification. So the Puppet file
including the web app?
Not the web app. So the web app building part is coming later in my build phase.
How do you, I suppose, I see a bit of a disconnect between
yeah.
the infrastructure and the application. So how do you coordinate between pushing a new infrastructure, the new infrastructure and the new web application?
Mm-hmm.
Say, if you have a new configuration and we have infrastructure,
mm-hmm.
and that web application depends on it,
yeah.
how do you manage that?
So typically how they did it was, the Git template, it had the application, so basically that Git template was from the application branch, right? And I changed that particular thing. So the Git template would also have what kind of, which Git URL the application is hosted on, right? And that would become as an input to this particular template, right? When I reach the application phase, I already have that Git URL that where I should hit my build, right? So I would I would give Jenkins that input and we'll basically build that and then go ahead and deploy it. Right. So entire thing means whatever is needed for my application to run, that is being hosted in that one Puppet file. Yeah.
Is this still open source?
No. So this is a proprietary. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. And you can catch me at the booth if there are any more questions.